What's happening? This is Avadon, and welcome to another episode of Beats for Breakfast. Today, I am joined by a very, very special guest. I am joined by the host of the Spawn Cast and also the morning show Spawn Newswave. I will say Spawn Wave, Newswave, and Tech Wave. We have a lot of shows, but yeah. The host of many shows, we have John from Spawn Wave. How you doing, man? Thank you so much for coming on.
Oh, of course. Thanks for having me.
Anytime. I have to really say congratulations, because I saw on March 8th, you was trending on Twitter, which is an amazing
yeah. I'm in Mortal Kombat, yes.
definitely. Nah, I had to make that joke. I saw it. I was like, that was cool. But also, before we get into this, because I'm just curious, what type of music do you like? Just as an icebreaker question.
That's a good question. You know what? I've never got super into music, like, to the point where it was, like, a hobby of mine or anything. Usually I would just listen to whatever was just, I guess, on the radio at the time or anything. I guess I would lean more towards, like, I guess at the time growing up, like, rock music. I know, like, when I was in high school, Breaking Benjamin was, like, stupidly popular, and so was, like, Linkin Park. But for the most part, I guess some things with energy, like if I'm in the gym or something, is usually what I'll listen to, or some kind of good video game music or something.
Nice. That's... Honestly, Linkin Park was big and me growing up as well. I think I forgot the name of the song, but it's big in the end. Linkin Park.
Oh yeah, that was insanely popular. That was everywhere.
That was definitely around the same time for me growing up. So I definitely understand it. But you have a really successful channel with almost 400,000 subscribers, and I'm curious to know, how would you describe that journey in itself? It's only been a few years. A lot of people can't say they reached that milestone in just a few years. How would you describe the journey and evolution of Spawn Wave?
It's gone very fast, I'll say. It's been, I mean, there's a lot of stuff that ended up going into it, and some luck involved, and it was just this process that feels like it was done in a flash almost, but there was a lot of long nights and stuff that went into it. But it was fun. I guess that's what I'll say. It was fun. You know, it's one of the most fun, I guess, quote unquote, job that I've had ever. So
I could imagine it seems like you got a great job. It's like what it's kind of almost like a segue to the next question. But I was always impressed with the format. You know, the format was the same Monday through Friday, and then I saw we started adding, you know, the Saturday shows. It's really good, because it also shows that you also read the comments, you know, for the community. It was really cool that, you know, you showcase, you know, people's comments on the Saturday show. So being that consistent with that great quality, as you mentioned, there was some, you know, long nights. There was some shared challenges. What were some of the other challenges that you have faced when it came to the production of Spawn Wave?
Because it's like it's set on a certain schedule, so sometimes you're time limited as well. So you feel like you're up against the clock at times because of that. But I think especially now with the way YouTube works, notifications that having a schedule so that people know when the stuff's going to be there is like one of the most important things ever right now. Like running on like a schedule. To where the video's there. Usually the video is done, Newswave is done like the night before as we work through it overnight. So that's the biggest challenge, I would say, was that. And then trying to figure out all the audio and editing, because I'm not a big editor or anything. So trying to figure all of that out, and camera equipment, all of that stuff was extremely challenging. The other stuff I know, but trying to figure out all of that and put it all together was probably, I would say, the most challenging part. Everything else kind of came naturally through progression with on-camera work and all that, but like trying to figure out, you know, which camera to buy and how to set up your microphone and like soundproofing a room, that was probably the biggest challenge at the time.
Nice. Do you have, well, because like, you know, you face those challenges, do you have any advice for people who would say, you know, what's like good sound equipment set up for, you know, what would you say is like a great mic for people to buy, or even the great a good camera, or even good soundproofing? Because you use them for myself, for an example. I use the Yeti mic, and I use the Logitech C920 camera. And I also, the one thing I don't have is soundproofing. So one of the challenges that I face is often reverb issues.
Yes.
So yep. What is your advice in helping get rid of like reverb or even just letting your sound quality be consistent?
For reverb, what we started doing was in the new office has a fairly couple of larger rooms that are all the sound bounces around a lot. So what we ended up doing was we ended up creating sound panels. And it's basically, we got some hard boards. So not really poster board, but it's a little thicker, like at a Home Depot or Lowe's or something. And then we put some rock wall insulation. It's insulation that's designed to kill reverb. And then we just took some fabric and wrapped it around it. And it was pretty cheap to do. So I think we can make 8 panels out of it or something for a couple hundred dollars, which if you buy one sound panel that's really good, those are $70 or $80. So we ended up doing that, and that worked out pretty well. But otherwise, you can hang some moving blankets. That's something else we played around with, and that worked better than I thought it would. And moving blankets are pretty cheap. You can get them for $7 or $8, and you just tack them up on a wall, and that'll kill reverb too. Where you just hang it in the middle of the room, and that'll help. I think you have the right setup though with your, I think a Yeti mic and the Logitech 920. I think those are great places to get started for anyone who just wants to jump in. Otherwise, you can use your phone. iPhone cameras are ridiculously
iPhone
good now.
And Samsung even.
Samsung, they're so good now to where you can do that and it'll work for just get. I know Dreamcast guy got to 100,000 subscribers just using an iPhone.
Yeah, so, I remember that.
You can do that, but if you ever want to upgrade to something else, I like the Panasonic G7 to get to be the next step up. I think that's a great camera for the money.
Nice. I will definitely look into that because as you know, even I'm growing, I know some people who are probably around the same area as I am. When you start wanting to vlog, go to conventions, you know, you want to have a travel camera. And sometimes you may not want to use my phone. My phone is fully capable. I have a Samsung S10, and even that phone has great sound quality to it, but you still, sometimes you want something that's more dedicated to, you know, this is only for recording, so.
Yep, and you can take extra batteries with you and have them charged so you can pop them in and out as you need to. And the G7's good. It's not stupidly expensive. People think thousands of dollars for some of these cameras. I think it's $400 or $500, and it comes with a lens and it has a flip out screen and everything.
I'm definitely gonna look into that. Gonna look into that. But what I've always admired about your channel, as I mentioned, was consistency. Do you have any advice on how to stay consistent? And to paint it a little bit more real, how to stay consistent even when you don't feel like it?
That's tough. That's tough. I mean, consistency, it comes down, one, to dedication and the desire to really want something. That's the biggest part. And then after that, you have to really set your mind and schedule to, you really got to schedule around it. You got to be all right, I'm gonna make sure this video is done and ready to go at this time. And that time's going to be at least 6 hours before the video has to go live the next day or something, or 7 hours. And you know, sometimes you're going to be up late at night doing it, and that's the way it is. But it really can be kind of tough sometimes. But if you do view it as something that has to get done rather than something I want to get done, it does make things a bit easier to actually finish it and get it out on time.
I have to agree. That's how I've gotten mostly even these episodes up with editing, because unfortunately for me, I had to teach myself how to edit because I didn't know how to edit videos. I didn't know how to do anything when I first started YouTube. It's something that I just had to.
Hey, YouTube's good for that.
Exactly.
Put some stuff up. There you go.
So I just had to learn. But you're right. I could relate to that. The times where I said, no, this has to get done, somehow it got done. So
yeah. Yep.
But I want to ask you just about the channel, because it's really cool to see the channel grow. Congratulations on the office, by the way.
Oh, thanks.
What were some of your most memorable experiences with the channel that you have had?
The most memorable, that's a good question. Most memorable experiences. I mean, I enjoyed going, we had a lot of conventions that we would go to, and those were really fun. Like, you know, getting to see everybody in person and have some fun there and meet other creators. That was always, I think, the most fun part with the channel was being able to meet other creators and learn things from them. That was cool. But then also working with, like growing up, watching, I was a big fan of G4, and that's one of the reasons I wanted to do like a news show that was on weekdays and everything, because that's what I grew up with, was G4, and you'd go home and you'd watch X Play
or Game, or back it was called GameSpot TV. I remember. Yep. That. So yeah,
and you knew it was on. You knew it was like you go home, you watch Toonami or G4. You know, it's like one big block while you're doing your homework, or you just didn't have any homework to do, and you would just go home and watch it. But being able to work with talk to some of the people that were on that show, like doing a collaboration type thing or being in a video with Victor Lucas, that was pretty cool. Like having something nice like that, you know, to be like, oh, you get to that point where YouTube affords people a lot of opportunities that didn't exist back then. And those are probably the best parts of the channel, was getting to the point where you can do that kind of stuff. You know, you talk to people at larger publications that you would just read, you know, like IGN and all these other places that you would just read, and now you're to the point now where you're able to be a part of it at times.
Yeah, because I was gonna say, because now your channel is more so in the leagues of that. It's something that many people look forward to every single day. You know, it's a part of their routine. I would almost consider, even though it's shorter form, it's almost like your episodes are like mini podcasts in a sense, because you could literally listen to it on the go.
Sure.
Everything that you do is like you could listen to, you could just throw it on and it could be on it in the background as someone's literally getting ready for work. So it's like being a part of someone's daily routine in terms of like their into gaming news. It's like it's pretty awesome.
I try to keep it like so there's a bit of normalcy for people, like with the routine and everything. They can wake up, or even some people tell me because they're on a different part of the world, they go to sleep with it or whatnot. Like, you know, they're watching it later at night. Other people watch it during the day and the morning. So I like to have a little bit of normalcy there with people's lives with that. So
That's cool. Well, this was just the introduction. We're going to give you guys a small, quick commercial break. I'm going to go ahead and let you see some of John's work. And we're going to be back shortly, and we're going to discuss more about gaming journalism. Stay tuned.
Animal Crossing New Horizon is probably the most dangerous release this year so far for video games. Like, seriously, I was supposed to have made this video yesterday, and you know what I did instead? I played Animal Crossing. It went something like this. All right, I went ahead and completed the first day or so. Several hours have been clocked in, done a lot, and just waiting for some shops to be built. Wait, what was I supposed to be doing again? This game is stupidly addictive. Seriously, it is like, I know people say that about a lot of games. Animal Crossing is like to the next level. And the last Animal Crossing I got into was on the GameCube. The other ones, I'll be honest, I played them, they just didn't grab me as much. The GameCube version came out when I was in, I think it was end of middle school, early high school, I think. And yeah, that would have been around there. And that's when I really played it. And I enjoyed it with my brothers, and we had a lot of fun with it. And it was on the GameCube, of course, so visually it was an Nintendo 64 game that was just cleaned up, but I still really enjoyed it. And the other ones, I don't know, they didn't feel like massive step forwards, I guess, in the grand scheme of things for Animal Crossing, at least to me. But New Horizons seems to change that quite a bit. So first thing is you pick an island.
Welcome back. I hope you guys enjoyed that commercial break and some of John's work. If you haven't already, make sure you hit that subscribe button if you are not subscribed already, which is a very impossibility. But if you are not, make sure you go ahead and subscribe to his work, because he does gaming news, does tech breakdowns. Tech Wave is amazing. I always love Tech Wave. So make sure you guys go ahead and subscribe. But moving forward, I wanted to ask, you know, as a successful gaming news channel, this week is an exception. This week is hot. We got a whole bunch of news this week to talk about. But, you know, how do you guys, and I'm curious to know, how do you guys overcome drought periods?
That's a good question. That's actually a very good question. So the best way to look at it is, even if there's a drought period, there's still usually something to talk about, but you might have to expand, I guess, the scope a little bit. So if there is a game that's even getting it, that gets like a demo, and because that can get kind of hidden. Let's say like Trails of Cold Steel 3 got a demo on the Switch, and not a lot of people know that because it's on the Japanese eShop, but they might want to try it. That's a good piece of news there that you can put in there that may go under the radar. A lot of times it comes down to you just gotta look harder for the most part. A lot of times there's at least something to go over at some point in time because the gaming space is so massive, and sometimes maybe you go into technology as well. And maybe it's not just gaming. Maybe you talk about NVIDIA's latest like video cards or something as well. So there are usually, it might not look like there's a lot of stuff for the day, but then you kind of go and really start looking around and you will find pretty good amounts of information, but you just gotta be willing to research it, look for it, and then kind of go over it in a good way when you do find it.
I wholeheartedly agree. One of my good friends, like, she helped out with a few of the topics of the Chillcast at one point, and it was, one of the things I saw she shared on Twitter was a gentleman named by the name of Rory Steele. He basically modded a Xbox adaptive controller to his own controller that could play on the Switch for his daughter. So his daughter was using the adaptive controller playing Breath of the Wild, which I thought that was amazing.
Yeah.
Like, and I didn't see a lot of people talking about that. So you're right. There is always something. It's just that you got to look harder. You got to really look at things that probably aren't trending, and you just really have to look at what's being talked about. And it's a lesson that I've learned. So it's like to see that, you know, your channel is like dealing with it in many ways. The demos thing, that's brilliant. That's something that I wouldn't even thought about. So that's something that, you know, if you guys are watching, just like be on the lookout for demos, because demos are amazing. Final Fantasy VII is a good example of that. What were some of the aspects of gaming journalism, you know, that people may not know about on the back end? And I know some people may think what you do is easy. I sure don't, because I used to do gaming news, and it's not easy at all. It's very challenging at times. So what are some aspects that go into gaming news that a lot of people may not know about?
I guess the part that a lot of people may not know about is even everything leading up to kind of a show where it might have 7 or 8 topics in it. Each topic kind of gets looked over, you know, independently. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of time spent, like, seriously, just researching and kind of looking around to make sure things are correct. That takes probably the most amount of time over editing, filming, everything is that. And that's a part of the whole equation that just isn't really noticed or anything because it's off camera and it's all, like, kind of putting the show together. That's the part. Even when people are... if there is a full report or investigative report going on, there is so much time and effort put into it. And then people just read the final article and they don't know about, for some of those, you know, the weeks or even months that led up to it and collecting all the information. That's the part that is just, I think it's mostly underappreciated, but it's like something that people don't really even think about just because they, you know, they watch the show or read the article and then they kind of move on. But that's where the bulk of the time is spent, is before the presentation or the article.
Basically, the research, the cooking up, everything, that's the part that no one really gets to see, because you want to make sure you sound well-versed, and he's like, you know how everything leads up to it, so I get it. That goes in with the job. I understood when I had to do that. It's hard work. So again, I really salute to that. But I wanted to also ask, with the possibility, if it's still going to be there or not, which is more than likely we may not be for this year, for E3 2020, did you guys still plan on going there?
No, probably not. E3, I kept thinking about going, and I think the thing that would have really put me over the edge and made me go is if all three of the companies, the big three, were there, like Nintendo, Sony, and Microsoft, because Microsoft and Sony would have had their systems there, I would like to assume, like the Series X and the PlayStation 5. And I think hands-on time with those systems ahead of their release in that setting would have been very valuable to the channel. But in its current form now, where we don't even know if it'll take place, one, but two, with Sony not being there, I think that really hurts the overall feel of that of the event. I think if Nintendo had a new system or something as well, and it was like, okay, it's Microsoft and Nintendo there, both new systems, then, and Sony's not, then I'd have been like, okay, it's worth going. But the fact that it's just really Microsoft, and then Nintendo has their Direct, of course, but they don't have a live presentation, and then being able to play the games there can take hours of time standing in line. So you need to go with a full team, and there's a whole thing involved in the first place. But if at the end of that, there are systems to play that are brand new that I can give impressions on, then I think it's worth the effort. But in its current state, it's probably not.
I got it. I thought about going for the same reasons, and then when I heard that they were canceled, I was like, not this year.
Yeah.
That was literally my reason for going, and I just said, well, OJ's over in that side of town. We'll go ahead and drop in to see Player Essence. So that would have been fun. But I wanted to ask another thing, because I'm also curious on what also helped your channel to grow. Outside of consistency, as you have shown, that's helped your channel, what's another aspect that's helped your channel grow?
That's a good question. Outside of that, I think the show that really helps the channel grow, to be honest, is the Tech Wave stuff. I think that's because it was, people were doing it, but I don't know, I feel like maybe the spin I was putting on it was a little different. I was grabbing at one point some retro systems, and I was trying to put it together where people could more or less understand what was happening in the system. And some of the stuff I took apart was a little crazy, like the Panasonic Q, that's not something you see every day. And even when a system comes out for the first time, like the Xbox One X came apart day one, and like that does seem a bit crazy to take apart something so expensive. But I think Tech Wave is one of the biggest reasons outside of the news stuff and the consistency as to why the channel grew. And then I also, networking is very important, as you probably know as well. Networking helps a lot, whether it's collaborations or just meeting people in the industry, not even people on YouTube, just in general gaming industry. That's all stuff that also helps. So, but I would say probably Tech Wave, just because it was fairly unique for me to be doing. What I was doing helped a lot.
I remember when I first subscribed to your channel, you took apart the Joy-Con.
Yeah, that one helped a lot, because a lot of like Yahoo and like CNN and stuff reported on it.
Yeah, so that was around the time I was subbed. I was like, okay, this is pretty cool, and I've just followed ever since. But we're gonna go ahead and take one more commercial break. Quick show today for you guys, and this is it's jam-packed, though. This is a lot of good information. So make sure you guys, once again, are subscribed to John's channel and also this channel, too. If you like this content, subscribe, please.
Xbox. But just for fun, here is a montage of me taking the Xbox apart to Halo music. So I ended up spending some time with the...
Welcome back. Hope you enjoyed the commercial break. We're going to talk a little bit about gaming music a little bit, because John, I saw your video about Final Fantasy VII Remake, and I even saw your tweet where you described the music as being next level, where they really stepped it up. And I'm also interested in hearing like your thoughts further on like, what do you think about the music so far, and what are some of the, if you remember the older soundtrack, what are some of the songs you look forward to hearing?
So I mean, the one that I really look forward to seeing probably won't be, I guess it wouldn't be in this. I don't know. It's hard to. I really need to see when it's going to end. Like the the first is, because there's gonna be some stuff in there, and I guess people say it's spoilerish, whether it's certain events in the game is what I'll say. But there's a scene where one of the main characters will say goes away. There's a song around that time that I'm curious. I just want to see how they approach that entire scene, because in the beginning of the demo, they had music and sound and all, everything was flowing so nicely with like the choreography and stuff that was happening on screen. Mm-hmm. And I think they're going to have a track ready for that, the scene I'm alluding to. And I think it's going to be extremely powerful. So I'm looking forward to that and how they use kind of the music and set the, like kind of the scene with that whole thing. That's the part I'm looking forward to the most though, is how they, I don't think it's going to be in this one. I think it's going to be in the second game. But I think if you're a Final Fantasy VII or fan in general, you're probably looking forward to that whole part.
That it's going to be crazy. I feel goosebumps when I play this game from a music sense, even just in general, because the goosebumps I felt the goosebumps when they was doing the intro. When the orchestra hit, I was like this. I felt like I was a kid all over again. I felt like it was 97 all over again. I wasn't prepared to hear half the things I heard with Final Fantasy VII. And what I actually took some time to actually play the game, and I heard like the bombing mission, I heard like some of the battle songs. There was one thing that I've noticed, and I didn't notice it until right before I played the demo, but they remixed the boss music, the original boss music, which the rendition was, it was changed so drastically, but it was in a way that I wasn't upset, which surprised me, because that was one of the top, you know, favorite songs in Final Fantasy VII, the original boss music. So to hear that song redone in a way that I would say is tastefully done, I want to see how they're going to continue to do the music. I wanted to go forward and just ask your opinion on this. This is an orchestral soundtrack, and this is a transition from MIDI to orchestral, and a lot of music is transitioning from being a MIDI based soundtrack to orchestral. We've been seeing that with indie games like Monster Boy and a few other games that I've got a chance to play where it's more orchestral than anything. What are your thoughts on that? Is the orchestral change better for the quality of music in general, or do you like prefer the MIDI?
You know, I'm okay with the orchestral, especially if it's like a bigger budget style game like a Final Fantasy VII. I mean, I don't think they could put those kind of visuals and that setting and that mood and then necessarily put just like the MIDI music. I feel like they had to evolve it in some way. But if it's like a new game that comes out and it's clearly designed, like if it's like a Shovel Knight or something, right? I look at that and I say, okay, yeah, no, that makes sense, MIDI music. But if they're trying to take an older game and completely blow it up and make it like this brand new remake style thing, I think it's completely, I'm fine with it going to like this nice grand orchestral thing. But it also does increase the budget and all this other stuff as well. So there is a lot. It also probably, I'm sure, increases the amount of time it takes to make it, to do all of that. If you see the behind the scenes stuff, it's insane with what they have to get done with it. So there's a lot that I guess they really have to account for. But for me personally, just from what I saw there when we were jumping off the train, it was nuts. So I like the orchestral stuff and how it was all kind of designed. So it might not be great for, I mean, they're probably happy with how it comes out, but I'm sure the process can be aggravating for them and time consuming. So
I agree. I feel, you know, looking at it, you see the, it fits, you know what? This is the best way to describe it. It fits more like a movie score. Like this game feels more like a movie score than a gaming soundtrack. And I think that's something that should be notated, because you don't see that often. I do acknowledge some good gaming soundtracks like Xenoblade Chronicles 2 or even, what was that game? God of War for the PS4 had great music. So I would say, you know, gaming music with when it comes to orchestral soundtrack can work, but when it hits like it's a movie score and things are hitting right at the exact points, it's, I feel like they're paying it so many close, such a close attention to detail with this game, even with the lip syncing, we don't even see that as much. That is really impressive to me. So now I have one weird thing that I have with video games. And I'm curious to know if this is the same for you. Does the music often determine how long you can play a game? And I'm curious to know if that's the same for you.
Does the music? I mean, you mean if it's like annoying or something, or
yeah,
if it's
or if it's like if the music is catchy? Because for me, if the music isn't captivating or doesn't catch me, it's like I'll play the game, but it's like I notice music where the music is really good, I tend to play longer than I would a game that doesn't really catch me. That doesn't mean I won't play it. I just probably won't play it as long.
Oh, I see what you're saying. It might depend, because honestly, I might, sometimes I'll even, if it's a game that I've been going through a lot, maybe I'm like, maybe I'm just grinding levels or something. I'll listen to a podcast or something else, to be honest, or watch TV or something while I'm playing it. So I won't even really be hearing the soundtrack. Mm. I think the soundtrack, a lot of times, and the choices that they make with where that is, more or less to me, it just affects my first impression of a game. And if it's like, we just talked about Final Fantasy VII Remake, the beginning of that and how hard-hitting that was, like, that's a good first impression. To me, that's more how much it can grab me right away rather than the longevity of the game and how much fun I can have with it after the fact. Like I said, I'll just turn it off and I'll listen to something else or, like, a podcast or something while I'm playing.
That's what I do when I'm playing, like, MMOs or I'm playing an RPG. Like you said, you have to grind up. That's usually what I do.
Yeah, so I'll usually find something else to listen to or something while it's going on. So.
Okay, and just wanted to ask another thing. So since we're still in that orchestral discussion, is gaming music as memorable as it used to be?
Oh, that's a good question, because now we're taking... because you got to think about anything brand new. I don't know. I don't know if you're ever going to get something as memorable as like the original Super Mario. You know, like that's still
being
remixed now. You still hear, we just talked about Final Fantasy. You hear a lot of Final Fantasy music still being redone and taught. You know, I don't think so. I think the older music's still more memorable overall than the music now by far.
Agreed. It's like I still remember soundtracks from Super Mario RPG, Chrono Trigger, Trials of Mana. A lot of these soundtracks. Well, it doesn't help them. I'm playing Trials of Mana again, but even before that, these soundtracks I still remember more than a lot of modern soundtracks.
But even if you take like ones that were kind of put together, like Tony Hawk, the original one, and you grab that was music that existed that was like licensed stuff. But like you go back and you'll like just them putting that together, and everyone remembers the music from that, you know, even though it was just music that existed. I don't know. They were good at, like, just mashing music up, too, in their own, like, soundtracks. I feel like, yeah, I think, like, the 90s and the early 2000s had some great, like, video game music. So.
Metal Gear, the Kingdom Hearts.
Yeah.
It's like they had a lot of good music. Even the original Phantasy Star Online, like a lot of memorable music.
That was weird because that was like, like an MMO style game, and that had some good music. So
it did. That game actually was the game that got me into MMOs.
Like, sure.
Yeah, I played it on I played it on Dreamcast with the old 56K modem dial-up connection. So days, but want to ask you one last question. I ask almost every creator this question before we close out. What is your advice to content creators on just growth in general, on how to create a strong brand?
Creating a strong brand would be to put it wherever you can, but like to really show it off and put it. People will be concerned about, for example, like making too many videos. I don't know if you can make too many videos necessarily, just the way YouTube is right now. I think at times people will just get down on what they're creating and then they just won't make any videos. And I think that's probably the worst part. So the best advice to creators is to get up and create. That's the best advice I can really give, because you'll learn from doing anyway. So like editing, for example, you'll learn by editing more, and filming, you'll learn by filming, and audio and all that. So that's the best thing you can do as a creator. It's just try to just put out videos and learn from it. And a lot of times people who watch it will even comment and give you advice at times on what you can do better and your lighting and stuff. That I learned some stuff just from reading comments, because I read the comments all the time in the videos to pick out one. So like back then I was reading through and people were telling me, you should try this, you should maybe open the blinds for a window to get some light, and if you don't have lighting, or try this lighting. Those were things that I read in the comments as I went through earlier on. So my best advice for creators is to just get out there and make some videos.
I agree. That's literally what it takes as someone who, you know, does music or does art in a sense. It's like you only get better by practicing. You know, the old adage rings true. Practice makes perfect. Mm-hmm. Need to practice. If you don't practice, you can't get good. It's like everyone that is great at something practices. You look at, you know, look at basketball, Stephen Curry, LeBron James, practice. You look at Tom Brady, or you look at look at even, I'm trying to think of other sports. I only watch football and basketball sometimes.
So. sure.
So I'm rusty. But if you look at anyone who practices, you know, they are often good at what they do. So keep practicing. So with that, thank you, John, so much for coming on. It's been great having you on. Record time on the show.
Oh, nice.
Record time on the show is great. Hope everyone got a lot from what you had to say and the wisdom that you shared. Make sure you guys go ahead and follow John's channel if you have not. Follow him on Twitter. His information is down below. If you guys enjoyed this video, hit that like button, hit that subscribe button, and most of all, you make sure you share this with a friend. This is David Dodd and John from Spawn Waving. We are out. Peace.